Hi, welcome to Books in Action. My name is Larry Pietrocchiaro, and tonight we're going to talk about the 2015 Summer Reading Program. And I have with me four librarians, as you might expect. Starting on my left, Keisha Miller. Keisha is teen librarian and volunteer coordinator at South Orange Library. Beth Halliday.
Hello.
Beth is head of Children's Services at South Orange Library. And then Irene Langlois. Irene is the teen librarian, head of teen services, I guess it is. And then Emily Witkowski. And Emily is the children's librarian at Maplewood. Both Irene and Emily are at Maplewood Library. And I think I managed to pronounce all those names correctly, so I'm going to give myself credit for that. But we want to talk about the upcoming program, and I have some questions, and we can go through those. And I don't know the best way, so I guess I'd like all of you to kind of try not to interrupt one another, but, you know, pitch in an answer. So let's start with a quick description of the summer program, the summer reading program. And let's start with, let's start with Beth.
Thanks.
Like it or not.
Well, I was just thinking while you were introducing us that the really great thing is that since we share a school district, the kids in both towns can join both library programs, summer reading programs, which is something that we go to every school in the district. And we talk about the summer reading program, and we invite the kids of all the schools to come and join both libraries' reading programs, because both libraries do it a little bit differently, mm-hmm. but they're able to participate in two towns' libraries. So there's three libraries that they can go to, two in Maplewood and one in South Orange, and still be part of summer reading, whatever's most convenient. And all the libraries are doing, each library is doing something different, so there's something fun, you know, when we go to the schools to talk to them. We show them our programs and we say, there's something to do almost every day between one of the three libraries.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But what is it about? It's about getting kids to read over the summer and keep reading over the summer and keep their, when we go, one of the things we like to say is that when we visit them, we always say that if you don't read over the summer, when you go back to school, it takes 3 months to catch up. Studies have shown that. So I tell the kids, if you don't read over the summer, the rest of the kids are learning and it won't you'll be still trying to figure out by Thanksgiving what everybody else is doing. But we want it to be fun, so that's always
Oh, fun helps if you're a kid.
Fun helps, yeah. So there's a lot of fun.
Just a quick digression, Beth. Before we started, you were telling me about the experience your daughter had up in Westchester. Maybe you could repeat that to all of us, because I think it really highlights the importance of reading and would highlight the importance of trying to participate in this program.
Right. So my daughter's a first grade teacher at a private school in Westchester, and she said that she can tell when the kids come in, the kids who haven't been read to, as, you know, the story time every night or just sitting around the kitchen table reading aloud to each other, those are the kids who really struggle. This is in a wealthy community where they're not being read to or not trying to read aloud themselves. So this year on everybody's report card, she was going to write, go to the library this summer and explore the library and the reading materials available there, because we're the experts and we can help kids pick out things that maybe their parents don't know anything about. You have an iPad, you go to Amazon, doesn't mean that you know all the things that are available to your kid or what they're interested in reading about. That's another thing.
Well, there's a lot more to libraries
right.
anyway than just books
right.
these days. So,
mm-hmm.
But maybe, Irene, we can give Maplewood a chance to say
yeah.
something.
Okay.
What's the, is the theme of the reading program the same for both communities?
Yeah, there's a collaborative summer reading program that is nationwide. So we do use similar themes, but just how we run the programs tends to be different. This year for teens in Maplewood, we're actually doing I'm actually going a little bit out of the box, and we're doing two things. For an incentive for to keep the kids reading and writing, they'll be getting a marble notebook, and believe
Love
me,
them.
They're excited about that. But in it is prompts for them to write essays,
oh, that's so cool.
and Zentangles, which are sort of like a Zen doodle, I guess is the best way to put it. And just things, places where they can scribble and make lists. And so this is what they're going to be doing this summer. So it keeps them reading, because they have to write book reviews in here too, but it also keeps them writing. So that's one part of what we're doing. And then for teens, for program-wise, we're going to have a create camp. We have a makerspace at the Hilton Branch. And we'll be having a lot of STEM programming, basically, for the kids.
Well, STEM, just for people who may not be familiar with it, is?
Science, technology, engineering, and math. And if you want to throw an A in there for STEAM, you get the arts as well.
Oh, I like that.
Okay.
I really like that.
Now, is the STEM program or the STEAM program directed primarily at young girls, or is it directed at everybody?
It's directed at everybody, but there is, you know, I'm going to be having a few things that are definitely more girl-orientated. You know, we're going to bling a vase, and that might be not so much for the boys. But we're going to have 3D CAD designing. There's going to be coding classes, and then there's going to be circuitry classes as well. So it's really going to be a mixed bag for both the boys and the girls.
If I may, just follow up on that. What do you mean by coding, and what do you mean by circuitry?
Coding, I mean computer programming, because there's been a big movement over the last year to get kids involved in programming computers, because they're great users. But unlike some of us who were there at the beginning of the personal computer and had to actually program it, these kids don't know how. Mm-hmm. So there's a big movement to sort of get these kids into programming so they can, you know, for career, for just basic information, just to know how to do it, know what's going on behind what they're using. So that's the coding. Circuitry is probably more of the, you know, engineering and technology, a lot of electronics. Like one thing they're going to build is a flashlight out of a little mint tin. Hmm. With, you know, a little LED light and a battery and wiring, and so they're going to learn basic stuff. So it's a little bit of a movement back to some basic making that we've sort of moved away from.
Any kind of mint?
I was going to say Altoid, but I am collecting.
All right, so collecting.
So if anybody
tins.
Has some tins, please send them my way.
Okay, so you heard that. Tens. Now, Keisha, what about South Orange doing that's a little bit different or the same, for that matter?
A little bit of both. We'll have some programming for the teens in South Orange as well. A couple of movie nights. The popular thing that I found is the garage gaming, which is we close the library. Well, when the library is closed, it's open to teens for a few hours. Kind of like an after-hours event where there are a host of different things. They'll have a chance to make things with a 3D printer. They'll have an opportunity to hang out with one another, do some old-school games like laser tag kind of thing.
Ping-pong table.
There'll be food. So I call that garage gaming. And it's an opportunity for them to come together to hang out and do different things. All at once, if you may. I'll continue with my book group, which was very successful this year. We'll talk about the campaign that has been going on, diverse books. We need diverse books. We'll talk a little bit about that. In addition to the summer reading program, I also have the teen volunteer program that has had a successful run for the last 5 or 6 years. So I'm taking applications for that now, and there'll be an opportunity for the teen volunteers to continue the good service that they've done in their school library. You know, they're known as library helpers, so they'll be giving back to their community on a much larger scale. One of two things is doing a food drive in the month of July. I'm going to have the teens get involved with that, and partnering with the South Orange Rotary, we'll be doing a back-to-school drive in the month of August. So those are two big projects, and then other things in the library and throughout the community we'll be doing as well.
These will be the volunteers?
The volunteers, yeah.
What's the back-to-school drive? Thanks.
Back-to-school drive, we're going to put up some signage, kind of be old school about it. You know, get boxes and collect items, notebooks, backpacks, you name it, anything to get the kids geared up for back-to-school in the month of August. You know, partnering with the South Orange Rotary will
donate
those items. Yes.
I just have to say, when you said old school and then you said laser tag, that tells me that not as old school as maybe it was. Now, Emily, you're the children's librarian now. Mm-hmm. We've talked a lot about what we're doing for the teens. What are we doing for the kids? The younger children.
Yeah, it's a mix of old and new. So we're going to do the traditional story times and crafts that people have come to kind of expect in the library over the summer. And since the superhero theme is here, we'll probably make some capes and some masks and kind of encourage them to be like embrace the hero in them sort of thing. But then I'm also trying to do some things geared towards older kids, more school age. So going off of that programming idea that the teens are going to be doing in the summer, we're going to be doing an unplugged programming. So on Monday nights, I'm going to have families come in and they're going to learn the concepts behind computer coding, but by physically maneuvering people. So writing lines of code to get someone through a maze or learning binary code through flashcards, that sort of thing. So kind of the concepts behind them in a really low-tech way.
And that would be for kids of what age? The youngest age, I guess.
We're shooting for that sort of like from first to fifth grade age group. So kind of those five-year-olds and up.
Okay. And what is the theme? It's heroes or something about
yes,
that?
Yes. Every hero has a story.
Every hero has a story.
Yes.
Okay. And that'll be for the teens as well?
Well, the teens have a different theme called Unmask, which kind of ties in with the hero theme as well. You know, unleashing, your inner hero. So the theme is Unmask.
Is that the same in Maplewood?
I'm doing do-it-yourself journal, but we do, it's sort of like a movement away from the theme, but the adults will also be doing Escape the Ordinary, because we have a summer reading program for adults as well.
Yes,
we
do.
Summer reading is for all ages.
That we should say that right off the
we
the
can't
very
emphasize
beginning,
that enough.
Yeah.
Because a lot of parents come in and we talk about it, they say, he doesn't know how to read yet. And we're like, but you read to him, and he or she opens a book and is reading, and we use that still as counting towards our summer reading program.
Do the adults get credit too, or is
yeah,
that just
yeah, credit.
Adults come on out and sign up for summer reading and have
we're really
fun.
Lucky local businesses donate, you know, a pizza or just an ice cream cone, and those are prizes that the kids get. We're really lucky in South Orange. The businesses are very generous.
Oh, that's good. In Maplewood, do you get the same sort of support?
Yeah, we do. Yeah, a lot of businesses.
So there are then, if not totally separate or totally different, three separate sorts of themes, one for the adults, one for the teens, and one for the children.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And those three elements are the same in both?
Well, it's a statewide theme.
Okay.
So, yeah, we should mention that it's a New Jersey, which the libraries are welcome to adopt the theme or not, but these themes are chosen like years.
Yeah.
Like
yeah.
They probably are up to like 5 years from now. The
really?
Theme, yeah. There's a committee that meets and they decide the theme, and then you tweak it any way you want. But this I really like because it's something to go in and really talk to the kids about heroes. It doesn't have to be Batman or Superman. Mm-hmm. It can be
local heroes.
Yeah.
Heroes. Yeah. Your librarian is your hero?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, well, should use them.
Exactly.
and are any of you on the that committee that picks the theme, or do we get representation from Maplewood or South Orange, or have we had in the past?
Not that I know.
I think Melissa was our director,
so
was on one of the
original. The committees for.
In fact, New Jersey, she said, was the first state to they created this idea of the summer reading theme, and that other states
really?
Have. Yeah, you might go to another state and see them doing
the same thing.
Same thing, but it was New Jersey that started.
Started.
It.
Well, that's good to know.
Yeah.
We're gonna have to take a break, and we'll be back in a minute. So if we'll just stay, we'll continue to talk. So if you'll stay with us, we'll be back in a minute.
After 17 years working as a mason, Mike was laid off. I met him when he came into the library looking for help. He found a job opening, but the application was only online. Mike said he'd spent his entire life around tools, but had never used a computer. I showed him how, and he ended up applying for numerous jobs online. I saw Mike the other day. His new computer skills paid off. He's working again.
New Jersey libraries are transforming lives. Tell us your story.
Okay, we've been talking about the summer reading program, the 2015 summer reading program, with Keisha Miller, Beth Halliday, Irene Langlois, and Emily Witkowski. And I got that right again the second
yes,
time.
You did.
Okay, doing well. So, How many years has the program existed, the reading programs in Maplewood and South Orange?
Well, at least since 1963 in Maplewood, but it probably could have been earlier than that.
Right.
But that's as far our records go back.
And I would presume the same in South Orange, since I guess the community.
It's funny how we look through local history documents and we find things that just, you know, tickle us. You know, how the program was implemented or how it was run, say, back in the 60s. And
it's a little more structured, I would say.
In the 60s?
Yeah, which is kind of ironic, the 60s. But it was a little, the way I look at the records, it was a little more rigid in terms of actually asking kids questions about what they read. We don't do that. No.
Don't do that anymore.
No. And I think it was a lot less active. I mean, our records show there was about like 200, 300 kids. Now we get over 1,000 kids in each library.
In each library.
So it's a different group.
Definitely a staple in the community that people run to. They flock to for information.
Makes
sense to have those numbers.
I'm sure you've had the same thing where people have walked in not knowing and said, "Are you having day camp here?" No, it's just summer reading in the library.
Well, the reading program, obviously you hope they'll come to the library to take out books, but what else qualifies, or does anything else qualify as reading material that they can get credit
question.
For?
Good question.
This was a question that came up. We all do school visits like Beth mentioned, it's a question that comes up all the time. You can read in any format. They don't have to be, they don't have to be books about the theme.
That's
so it doesn't
true.
Have to be books about Superman
okay.
or Superwoman.
Or from the library.
Or from the library. I've mentioned
bookstores,
you know, here in Jersey, in New York, wherever kids are going. They're traveling with their families, sleepaway camp. It doesn't matter where these books are from. Or what type they are, ebooks, audiobooks,
comic books.
It doesn't matter the format, as long as they're reading
right?
and getting ready for the next grade.
Yeah.
I think that's valuable. I mean, maybe when you talked about the rigidity of the 1960s, that you had to read a certain book or something, you know.
Yeah. There are school lists that are that go around. In fact,
which is another thing we're proud of. We collaborate the school
put together
and public librarians
a school list.
To put together a suggested summary list, which is really, I think, unique.
Yeah, here's the teens list somewhere.
So,
really, I'd like to see that.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, I've always been a fan of reading. If I have any hobbies, it's probably one of the few. And I've always felt sorry for people who don't even have the interest to read. I mean, there's such a world of information, of adventure.
Some
of the statistics on Americans, how much they read, is average is like one or two books a year.
Talked to a librarian and found out what they like to read.
Exactly. That's why my daughter's saying, go to the library, talk to the librarian. But how many times has that happened where somebody comes in and asks for one book and then you say, well, if they like this, then maybe your child would like that. I'm like, oh, I didn't even know about this book. And so that's why we're here.
Well, the theme is not exactly science fiction, but I have to ask that question because that was kind of the staple of what I read for probably 30 years or 40 years. Is science fiction something that kids read anymore? Or
it's more fantasy, dystopian, which is science fiction, but dystopian and post-apocalyptic, and you know, it's. But there is. I mean, and then what we do on the lists is we do different genres.
Hmm.
So especially for the teens, so kids can find things that they like in the genre that they know, but then they can also explore other genres as well.
Well, you mentioned Keisha that you actually have a book club.
Yes.
Does Maplewood have a book club as well for the teens?
Not at the moment.
So what? Can we describe a little bit? What do you do? You mentioned diverse books. I mean, is that racially diverse or gender diverse?
Diverse on
or?
All topics.
Okay.
Race, social issues, whatever the issue is.
But not gender diverse.
We can include.
You can, but boys. Come on out to the book club.
The club isn't.
I have to say, this was my first year doing a book club. And it's hard to get teens in to be a part of a book club. Mm-hmm. But I did have two boys,
okay.
I have to say. And I was like, yes, you know, this is working. I'll have some very laid back book discussions over the summer, kind of talking on the topic of diversity in books and literature. But really kind of, instead of me running it, letting the kids run it and giving me fresh and new ideas for the upcoming school year. I call them book chats.
Mm-hmm.
I give them pizza. You have to feed them. I give them pizza and we talk about the books that they're reading. Another opportunity for them to come into the library and socialize and be a part of a program. And summer reading.
Well, I've had not recently, but on Books in Action in the past, we've talked to kids, and I've always been, even the little ones, I've always been surprised at the insight and the things that they pick up. So I don't know if you find the same thing.
Yes.
You know, they we never give kids enough credit for their intelligence,
so right.
And for their, you know, their perception and their ability to reason. Then, we just don't, at least I don't think we do.
And the questions that they ask are
and the
really
issues that are important to them. You know, maybe we don't ask the questions. Maybe we're not taking the time to have that conversation, or we're just talking about the things that are important to us and kind of feel as if it should be important to them. Let's just open that dialogue.
Yeah,
and
point.
It's very, very interesting, the things that are important to them and those issues that we otherwise wouldn't think they take seriously.
One of the cool things about summer reading, I think, too, is we haven't really talked about it yet, but writing also counts as part of the program.
Right.
They can write in addition to read, and they get credit for that. And I think that's where you kind of see some of that stuff come out. They'll write about what they read or write about what they're thinking about or worry about. And it's interesting to see that come out in the summer when they don't need to be doing it.
Now, is that new, the writing? Has that been around for a few years, or is this?
It's been around for a few
years.
A few years.
Okay. I mean, like, how many? Or do you know? I shouldn't ask that question.
But that's
right?
Probably
I don't
what didn't
before.
Happen in the 60s.
Okay, no writing. Now, you talked about audiobooks and stuff. Every now and then I stumble across these old radio shows. And you know, you can get these, you can go on the computer and find these links to these, like the Green Hornet or other things. If they listen to a radio show, would they get credit for that? Would that be considered like an audiobook?
I would think
yeah,
so.
Why not?
Because it's a story. I think that's part of it is for them to learn. It's literacy. You know, they're still learning. They're still learning about the arc of a story.
Mm-hmm.
And
right.
So we would count that.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
Now, I'd be remiss if I didn't ask, are there prizes? I know in the past years, at least, there have been prizes.
Always prizes.
Larry, there's always prizes.
Well, sign me up. So what are the prizes for this year?
Well, for my teens in South Orange, a lot of them, as Beth mentioned earlier, the local businesses in town have been, they support our summer reading program immensely. They give us a lot of prizes, prize donations, which I'm able to give to the teens. Also, our friends group at the library, the Friends of the South Orange Public Library, they support the summer reading program as well. And
we couldn't do any of the programming
without
the support of the Friends of the Library. They, really.
They basically give us
the
money
for it. Yeah.
With the volunteer program that I have at the South Orange Library, the Municipal Alliance also supports the volunteer program, so I'm able to, with their help, provide a lot of the prizes as well, or funding for different programs.
But the prizes are pretty simple, but it's amazing how when kids come in and they just see, you know, a shelf full of tchotchkes that they get excited. So in South Orange, they're able to pick their prize from, there's different levels of, pull out a coupon and match it to the shelf, and they get to pick out a little prize every time they come. Once a day, but if they come 6 days a week, they can get 6 prizes.
How about the adults?
The adults,
we just ask them to rate the book that they've read, you know, kind of like a Goodreads, if you may. We tie it in with our Goodreads page, so we encourage the adults to do that, and prize donations from local businesses. We do a grand prize drawing for the adult summer reading program.
Do you have
that
too.
Do like a raffle.
It's like a raffle.
It's like a weekly
raffle. And it's just a random choice of
yeah.
Okay. Now, when does this start? And if it has a start date, is that like a hard and fast, like the 1960s, or can you pick up any time you want it?
Sign-up starts right around when school ends, and it lasts all summer long. And you can come to the kickoff parties that we'll be having
at both libraries. Ours is, tell you, Tuesday, June 23rd at the Hilton Branch Library.
Is the kickoff, and what will you do with the kickoff party?
Our kickoff is going to be a nice night of music and storytelling and face painting. So we're going to have some jazz and swing musicians come in and play at the gazebo outside of Hilton Branch. We're going to have an African storyteller come in, and she's also going to do some face painting. So it should be a nice family night.
And what about in South Orange?
South Orange, we're going to have a magician come in the evening, and during the day we'll have music also, and earlier in the day we're going to do some gardening. There's a small area in front of the library that we call the Children's Garden, and the kids really have fun planting and just throwing seeds in the ground. And
I'm just going to add to
digging.
That, Beth, our library is celebrating its 150th anniversary.
Yes.
Really?
Yes.
Congratulations.
SOPL 150, and so tying in with that on opening day, I've invited the teens to come and join us to do a time capsule. All important things, you know, that are important to them, highlighting, you know, talking about what we're talking about.
Buried in the garden?
Buried in the garden, and 100 years from now, whoever's around.
Well, we'll have to have it on Books in Action. Do you find that any particular age group are the biggest participants in the...
Children.
Children, I have to say, yeah.
Children meaning up through elementary school?
Or? Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's the predominant percentage of
the largest
of the kids?
A lot of kids would go away. You know, there's summer camp. We compete with summer camp, sleepaway camp. Which we also say the kids can keep track of what they're reading while they're at sleepaway camp and come back at the end of the summer and collect a couple prizes. But kids in these towns, you know, they're away, for some of them away for the whole summer, we found when we talk, right, at the school?
Yeah, absolutely, yeah. But like she said, you can participate whether or not you're here. You don't have to come to the programs. You can count your reading as you go and just come in at the end and collect your prizes.
Mm-hmm. Now, based on what you said, I presume that there's more effort, more challenge involved in getting the older kids to participate. Mm-hmm. Are there any things that we're doing differently to try to, you know, you've got the book group, are there any things I mean that
well,
you're
I'm doing,
doing
I'm trying
the
journal.
The writing, okay.
So we're gonna try that this year. And I think the programming has a lot to do with bringing them in, sort of focusing on what they like. So that's why I'm doing a lot of upcycling,
technology.
The 3D printer, right?
The 3D printer.
Both of you have the 3D
printer. Minecraft. We have family tech night at South Orange where we're going to put out, you know, different types of technology, invite families to come in and participate in what their kids are doing every day, you know, and that's find out about it. I mean, some of the parents...
There's something for everybody.
Yes.
Practically every day.
Yes.
Well, except that right now there's no time. I think we're out of time, so we're going to have to. I hope we've given you enough information about the 2015 reading program in South Orange and Maplewood. So join. Get your kids to join. And even if you're not a kid, you should join. So thank you for joining us on Books in Action, and thank you all for participating.
Thank you.